Good morning, students. I hope you all are safe and well at your home. So this video is for the students of class 9, subject science, chapter number 15, that is improvement in food resources. It's your lecture number 7. In today's lecture, I would be covering all the topics in a nutshell. So let's begin. Agriculture. What is agriculture? Agriculture is the process of growing of plants in an organized way for obtaining food. Okay, so this process is called as agriculture. Now, let us discuss some of the revolutions related to it. Green revolution. It is related to increasing food grain production. That is Green Revolution. Next is White Revolution. It is related to milk, better availability of milk. Next is Blue Revolution. Blue Revolution is related to increase in production of fishes. And last, that is Yellow Revolution. It is related to increase in production of oil. So these are the various revolutions you should know. Now, improvement in crop yields. You know that the food crop, it provides carbohydrates, proteins, fats, vitamins and minerals. Now, let us discuss the sources from which we get these carbohydrates, proteins, fats, vitamins and minerals. First is cereals. Cereals such as wheat, rice, maize, millets and sorghum. They provide us carbohydrate for energy requirement. Next is pulses. Pulses like gram, pea, pigeon pea, lentil, they provide us with proteins. So cereals provide us carbohydrates, pulses provide us proteins. Oil seeds. Examples of oil seeds are soya bean, groundnut, sesame, castor, mustard, linseed and sunflower. All of these provide us with necessary fat. Okay, now vegetables, spices and fruits, they provide a range of vitamins as well as minerals in addition to small amounts of proteins, carbohydrates and fats. The last but not the least, fodder crops. Examples like barley and oats, they are raised as food for the livestock. So are you clear about this? Now let us discuss about the various types of the crops on the basis of seasonal variations. They are kharif crops and rabi crops. So what are kharif crops? Crops which are grown in the rainy season from the month of June to October are called as kharif crops. The examples of kharif crops are paddy, cotton, soybean, maize, etc. And what are rabi crops? Crops which are grown in the winter season from the month of November to April. They are called as rabi crops. Examples of rabi crops are wheat, gram, peas, mustard, etc. So are you clear about this? Now you can differentiate between these two easily. Now this improvement in crop yield can be categorized in three categories. They are crop variety improvement, crop production improvement and crop protection management. So let us study these three in detail. First is crop variety improvement. So what are the techniques under this? The techniques are hybridization and genetic modification. So what is hybridization? Hybridization refers to crossing between genetically dissimilar plants to produce new type or hybrid. And this crossing may be intervarietal, interspecific, or intergeneric. Okay, and what is intervarietal? Inter means between. Varietal means varieties. So between different varieties, that is intervarietal. Next is interspecific, means between different species of the same genus. And last is intergeneric, means between different genera. So are you clear about this hybridization? Next is genetic modification. This process involves the introduction of gene. For example, DNA fragment, that is a gene. It would provide the desired characteristics. Means whatever the characteristics we want in that hybrid, it can be introduced through this gene or DNA fragment, which results in genetically modified crops. So these are the two techniques. Now, what are the factors for which this crop variety improvement is done? The factors are, number one, higher yield. Number two, improved quality, such as baking quality in wheat, protein quality in pulses. Number three, biotic and abiotic resistance, means resistance to biotic and abiotic factors. And what does biotic factors include? It includes insects, disease, nematodes, etc. These are the biotic factors. And what are abiotic factors? It includes drought, salinity, water logging conditions. Okay, this was the third factor. Fourth factor is reduction in duration of plant maturity. That is the fourth factor. Fifth factor is broad range adaptability of the crop plant under various environmental conditions. And the last factor is desired agronomic characteristics like tallness and profuse branching in fodder crops and dwarfness in cereals. So these are the various factors for which the crop variety improvement is done. Normally, one question arises from this part. So are you clear about this? Now next is crop production management. This crop production management includes three things. First is nutrient management. Second is irrigation. And third is cropping patterns. So let us discuss these three in detail. Nutrient management. So what are nutrients? Nutrients are the inorganic elements which are supplied to the plants by air, water, and soil. And how many nutrients are required by the plants? There are total 16 nutrients which are required by the plants. And these 16 nutrients, they are categorized as micronutrients and macronutrients. So what are macronutrients? Macro means large. So these are the nutrients which are required in large quantity. Examples are nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, calcium, magnesium and sulfur. There are total 6 macronutrients which are required by the plants. And what are micronutrients? Micro means small. So the nutrients which are required in small quantities, they are called as micronutrients. Examples are iron, manganese, boron, zinc, copper, molybdenum, and sulfur. There are total 7 micronutrients. How many were macro? There were 6 macro and 7 micro. So this was about nutrient management, and you should learn the examples carefully of these micro and macronutrients, because normally one question arises from this part that tell whether this nutrient is micro or macro. So learn it properly. So total macronutrients are 6 and total micronutrients are 7. This I told you right now. Now, from where does these nutrients are supplied to the plant? Carbon. Carbon is supplied through air. Hydrogen and oxygen are supplied through water. And remaining 13 nutrients, they are supplied through soil, which are grouped as macronutrients and micronutrients. So you will have to learn this table also. This table is given in your NCERT book as well. Now, what are manures? Manures are prepared by decomposing organic matter like plant waste such as straw and animal waste such as cow dung. So that is manure. And what are the advantages of manure? Number one, it enriches the soil with organic matter, which improves the soil structure and help in drainage and avoid water logging in clay soil. That was the first advantage of manure. Second advantage is that it enriches the soil with nutrients that increases the soil fertility. And the third advantage is it increases the water holding capacity of the soil. So these are the advantages of manure. Now, what are the types of manure? The types of manure are compost and green manure. So what is compost? Compost is prepared by decomposing plant and animal waste in pits. And when this compost is prepared with the help of earthworms, it is called as vermicompost. Okay, when the earthworms are involved, it is called as vermicompost. And this compost, it is rich in organic matter as well as nutrients. Next is green manure. Prior to sowing, plants like sunham or guar are grown and mulched by plowing into the soil. These green plants turn into green manure, which helps in enriching the soil with nitrogen and phosphorus. So this was about the types of manure. Now what is fertilizer? These are the salts or organic compounds that provide macronutrients like nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium to the soil. Okay, It provides which three nutrients? NPK. N for nitrogen, P for phosphorus, and K for potassium. And this fertilizer is used to ensure good vegetative growth, giving rise to healthy plants. Basically, what happens? Manure, it is organic matter, and fertilizers, they are made up of chemicals. So, judicious use of fertilizers. Fertilizers should be applied carefully in the terms of proper dose, time, and observing pre and post application precautions for their complete utilization. And second is, continuous use of fertilizers in an area can destroy soil fertility and also causes water pollution. So fertilizers should be used in a judicious manner. Now, there is an important point, that what is organic farming? Organic farming is basically a farming system with, number one, minimal or no use of chemicals like fertilizers or pesticides. Number two, maximum use of manure. Manure is organic in nature. Third, use of bioagents like biofertilizers or biopesticides. Fourth, with healthy cropping systems like mixed cropping, intercropping, and crop rotation. So, combining these four things, this system of farming is called as organic farming. So, are you clear about this? Now, this was about nutrient management. So, next is irrigation. Irrigation is a process of supplying water to the crops by different means of irrigation system. Okay, you know that crops need water. So, the process of supplying water to the crops by different means, that is called as irrigation. And what are the different means of irrigation systems? It includes wells, canals, river lifting systems, and tanks. So, these are the four irrigation systems which are being used to supply water to the crops. Now, next topic is cropping patterns. Various cropping patterns are employed for the crops, which include mixed farming, intercropping, and crop rotation. So, what is mixed farming? It is growing of two or more crops simultaneously on the same piece of land. Examples are wheat plus gram or groundnut plus sunflower. So these are the examples of mixed cropping. Now this mixed cropping, it reduces the risk and gives some insurance against failure of one of the crops. So you can say this is one of the advantage of this. Next is intercropping. Inter means in definite patterns, in lines, in rows. So what is intercropping? It is growing of two or more crops simultaneously on the same piece of land, but in a definite pattern. And what are the examples of intercropping? Examples are soybean plus maize. This intercropping helps to utilize maximum nutrients and it also prevents spread of disease and pest. So, what are the advantages of this intercropping? Number one, it checks pests and rodents and hence decreases the chances of spoiling of the whole crop. Number two, it helps to maintain the soil fertility. Number three, It increases the productivity per unit area. Number 4, it saves labor and time. And number 5, both the crops can be easily harvested and processed separately because they have been grown in definite patterns. So what is crop rotation? It is the growing of different crops on a piece of land in a pre-planned succession. And why is this done? It is done so as to get maximum returns. So what are the advantages of this crop rotation? Number 1, farmers can grow 2 or 3 crops annually. Number 2, best use of land with proper supply of nutrients. Number 3, it improves the soil fertility. Number 4, it avoids depletion of a particular nutrient from the soil. Number 5, it minimizes the pest infestation as well as disease. And the last is, it helps in control of the weeds. So these are the various cropping patterns employed by the farmers for the crops. Now, the third category is crop protection management. You know that the field crops, they are manifested by a large number of weeds, insect pests and disease. And if these weeds and pests, they are not controlled at the appropriate time, then what will happen? They can damage the whole crop. Now the question arises, what are weeds? Weeds are the unwanted plants in the cultivated field. And what are the examples of weeds? It includes Xanthium, Parthenium and Cypranus rotundus. Okay, these are the examples of weeds. Now, the question arises, how does these weeds affect the crop? They compete for food, space and light. That is the number one effect of the weed. Next is, these weeds, they take up the nutrients and reduce the growth of the crop. So, in this way, the weed affect the crop plant. Next is insect or pest. The insect or pest, they attack the different parts of the plant in 3 different ways. Now, what are those ways? Number 1, they cut the root, stem and leaf. Number 2, they suck the cell sap from the various parts of the plant. And number 3, they bore into stem and fruits. So in this way, the insect or pest, they attack the different parts of the plant. Now the last is disease. Disease in plants, they are caused by pathogens such as bacteria, fungi and viruses. And these pathogens, they can be present in and transmitted through the soil, water and air. Now, what are the methods to control weeds, insect pests or disease? Number 1, use of pesticides, which include herbicides, insecticides and fungicides to control weeds, insect pests and disease. But they should be used only as much as needed to avoid environmental pollution and health hazards. This is number 1 method. Number 2 is mechanical weed removal. Number 3 is preventive methods such as proper seed bed preparation, timely sowing of the crops, intercropping and crop rotation, they also help in weed control. And the fourth method to control weeds is the use of resistant varieties and summer plowing, in which The fields are plowed deep in summers in order to destroy the weeds and pests. So, by employing these methods, the weeds can be controlled. Now, next topic is storage of grains, means how the grains should be stored, or what are the factors which affect the storage of grains. Grains are affected by biotic and abiotic factors. Now, what are those biotic factors? It includes insect, rodents, fungi, mites, and bacteria. And what are abiotic factors? It includes inappropriate moisture and temperature. So, these are the various factors through which the grains are affected. Now, what are the effects? Degradation in quality, loss in weight, poor germinability, discoloration of produce. So, these are the effects which result in storage of grains. Now, what are the preventive and control measures taken? Number one, strict cleaning of the product before storage. Number two, proper dryness of the product first in sunlight and then in shade. And number three is fumigation using chemicals that can kill the pest. So, these are the various preventive and control measures taken for the storage of grains. So, this was all about agriculture. Now, let's proceed towards animal husbandry. So, what is animal husbandry? Animal husbandry is a scientific management of animal livestock. This animal husbandry has been categorized into four categories. They are cattle farming, poultry farming, fish production, and beekeeping. Now, let's start with cattle farming first. Why is this cattle farming done? Cattle farming is done mainly for two purposes. What are those two purposes? Number one, for obtaining the milk from dairy animals. And number two, for using the draught animals in agriculture and transport purposes. So, that's why the cattle farming is being done. Now, the question arises, what are dairy animals and draught animals? Milk producing females are called as dairy animals or milch animals. One and the same thing. And what are draught animals? The animals which are involved in farm labor or agriculture and transport purposes. They are called as draught animals. So, are you clear about the dairy animals and draught animals now? Now, this milk production, it depends upon the lactation period. Now, what is lactation period? It is the period of milk production after the birth of calf. And this long lactation period is a desirable quality to consider during cattle farming. That's why exotic breeds means foreign breeds. Examples are Jersey, Brown Swiss. They show long lactation period. They are crossed with local breeds. Local breeds means Indian breeds. Examples are Red Sindhi, Sahiwal. They show resistance to disease. That's why crossing is done between these two. And as a result of crossing, a new breed is obtained of high quality. Now, next point is about cattle shelter and cattle food. What type of shelter should be provided to the cattle? In cattle farming, the cattle shelter should be well ventilated hygienic and dry. Animals require regular brushing to remove dirt and loose hair. So this was about cattle shelter. And what about cattle food? Cattle food should include roughage and concentrates in balanced amounts. Okay? Now, what about disease? Cattle suffer from a number of diseases, and these diseases are caused by bacteria, virus, and parasites. The parasites can be external or internal. The external parasites, they live on skin and cause skin disease, whereas the internal parasites like worms, it affect the stomach as well as intestine, while flu, it damages the liver. So overall, what we can say, they affect the health as well as the milk production of the animals. And how can it be controlled? It can be controlled largely through vaccinations. So this was about cattle farming. Now proceeding to our next topic, that is poultry farming. This poultry farming targets egg production and meat production. So, what are layers and broilers? The poultry birds which are raised for egg production, they are called as layers. And the poultry animals raised for meat production, they are called as broilers. So, are you clear about this? Layers are related to egg production and broilers are related to meat production. That is an important point to keep this in mind. Now, similarly, here also crossbreeding is done between Indian and foreign breed. Indian breed, the example is Asil, and the foreign breed example is Leghorn. In order to obtain new varieties, okay, when the crossbreeding is done, a new hybrid is obtained which contains new varieties. And that contains the following desirable traits. They are number and quality of chicks, dwarf broiler parent, tolerance to high temperature, low maintenance requirements, and reduction in size of the broilers. So these are the following desirable traits in the new variety which is obtained as a result of crossbreeding in poultry farming. Now, let us discuss about the food requirement for the broilers and layers. Actually, the food requirements, they are totally different. How? Broiler chickens, they are fed with vitamin-rich supplementary feed, vitamin A and vitamin K, for good growth rate and better feed efficiency. Along with this vitamin-rich supplementary feed, they are also fed with protein-rich diet with adequate amount of fat. Means they require vitamin also, protein also, and fat also. Whereas layers, layers need restricted and calculated feed. Means their feed is limited with vitamins, minerals, and micronutrients. So this was about the food requirement. Now about the shelter. It would be same as we discussed in cattle farming. It should be hygienic, well lighted, and maintained at appropriate temperatures. And what about the disease? They also suffer from the disease that are caused by bacteria, fungi, viruses, parasites, or due to nutritional deficiency also. And how can it be controlled? It can be controlled through proper treatment, sanitation, and vaccination. So this was about the disease. Now, proceeding to our next topic, that is fish production. Fish is a cheap source of animal protein for our food. Okay, it is a source of animal protein. So this fish production, it refers to capturing and culturing of fish as a source of edible animal protein for us. Edible means which we can eat easily. Now, what are the ways of obtaining fish? Basically, there are two ways of obtaining fish. They are capture fishing and culture fishery. Now, what is capture fishing and culture fishery? When fishes are obtained from natural resources, it is called as capture fishing. Okay. And when the fishes are obtained by fish farming, it is called as culture fishery. Now, let us discuss about marine fisheries and inland fisheries in detail. First is marine fisheries. It includes pomfret, tuna, mackerel, Bombay duck and sardines. These are the examples of marine fisheries. Means the fishes which live in marine water. And how are they located? They are located through satellites and eco sounders. And they are captured using fishing nets. Now some marine fishes, they are of high economic value. They are also farmed in sea water. This includes finned fish and shellfish. What are the examples of finned fish? Mullets, bhetki, pearl spots. And what are the examples of shellfish? They are prawns, mussels and oysters and seaweeds. So these are of high economic value. And there is a very interesting point to note about oysters. Oysters are cultivated for the pearls they make. So from oysters, what do we get? We get pearls. Now there are two terms in this fish production. The first term is aquaculture and the second term is mariculture. Now what is aquaculture and mariculture? Aquaculture, it is also called as aqua farming. One in the same thing, okay. Aquaculture is farming of saltwater and freshwater organisms like finfish, crustaceans, mollusks and aquatic plants. Okay, means it involves those organisms which live in salt water and fresh water. And what is mariculture? Mariculture is a specialized branch of aquaculture which involves the cultivation of marine organisms for food and other products in the open ocean. Mariculture is related to marine organisms. That's why the name is mariculture. So these are the two terms you should know. Now, what are inland fisheries? Inland fisheries include capturing the fishing from freshwater resources as well as brackish water resources. Now, what are freshwater and brackish water resources? Freshwater resources include rivers, canals, lakes, reservoirs, tanks and ponds. Whereas brackish water, what is brackish water? It is a mixture of fresh water and saline water. Okay, and the examples are estuaries and lagoons. Now this fish culture is sometimes done in combination with the crop, so that fish are grown in the water in the paddy field. And more intensive fish farming, it can be done in composite fish culture system. So let us discuss about composite fish culture now. What is composite fish culture? It is usually employed for freshwater fish farming. Now what happens? In this system, 5 or 6 fish species with different food habits, they are cultured together in a single pond. And why it is done? It is done so as to increase the yield of the fish. So this is composite fish culture. Now, what are the advantages of this composite fish culture? Number one, fishes, they do not compete with each other for space and nutrition. And number two, they live in distinct zones inside the pond. Distinct means different zones. Basically, there are three zones we will discuss now. So, what are the examples? Cutla and silver cap, they live mostly in surface zone. That is the first zone. So, that is also called as surface feeder. Next zone is middle zone. That is column feeder. Now, in this middle zone, rohu and grass crab, they live. And the last zone is bottom zone. That is also called as bottom feeder. And in this bottom zone, mrigal and common carp live. So these are the examples of the fishes which live in different zones. You have to learn the example as well. Now, if there are advantages of one thing, then there will be disadvantages as well. So what are the disadvantages of this composite fish culture? The disadvantage is that many of these fish, they breed only during monsoon season. Okay, so that is one of the disadvantages of composite fish culture. Normally, one question arises from this. What is composite fish culture? Write down its advantages and disadvantages. So you can answer it easily now. Now, the last topic of this chapter is beekeeping. The practice of beekeeping, it is called as apiculture. It is called as apiculture. Now, it is a low investment activity which involves rearing, care and management of honeybee. Okay, it is a low investment activity. And what do we get from bee? We get honey, wax, etc. Now, let us discuss some of the examples of different bee varieties. Indigenous bee varieties. The examples include Apis carina indica, Apis dorsata, and Apis florea. These are the examples of indigenous bee varieties. And there's a very famous Italian variety of a bee, that is Apis mellifera. It is an Italian variety which is used for the commercial production of honey. So you have to learn the examples as well. Now there is a very important question. What factors determine the quality and taste of honey? So the availability of sufficient amount of pasturage as well as the type of flowers which is available to the bees for nectar and pollen collection, they determine the quality and taste of honey. Pasturage means the flowers which is available to the bees for nectar and pollen collection. So the amount of the flowers as well as the type of the flowers, they determine the quality as well as taste of honey. Now students, I would be discussing the homework solutions of lecture number 6. So you can match your answers and correct there if any error. Question number 1 was, discuss the implications of the following statement. It is interesting to note that poultry is India's most efficient converter of low-fiber foodstuff, which is unfit for human consumption, into highly nutritious animal protein food. So the answer is, in poultry farming, the domestic fowls are raised to produce eggs and chicken, or you can write eggs and meat also. For this, the fowls are given animal feeds in the form of roughage that consists mainly of fibers. Thus, by feeding animals a fiber-rich diet, the poultry gives highly nutritious food in the form of eggs and chicken. Thus, it verifies the above statement. Okay, in this, you have to mention about the feed that is provided to poultry. Question number 2 was how are fish obtained? That is a direct question. You will have to explain about capture fishing and culture fishery. Fishes can be obtained by 2 ways. Capture fishing, that is a process of obtaining fish from natural resources. And culture fishery, that is a practice of farming the fishes. Question number 3 was, what are the desirable characters of bee varieties suitable for honey production? So that is also one direct question. The answer is, the desirable characters of the bee varieties suitable for honey production are, they should have high honey collecting capacity, they should sting less, they should stay in the beehive for longer durations, and they should breed very well. So these are the desirable characters of the bee varieties. Question number 4 was, what is pasturage and how is it related to honey production? Answer: pasturage is the availability of the flowers from which bees collect nectar and pollen. And how is it related? It is related to the production of honey, as it determines the taste as well as quality of honey. They also provide small amount of proteins, carbohydrates and fats, which are also present in them. Question number 5 was, how do good animal husbandry practices benefit farmers? Answer: good animal husbandry practices are beneficial to the farmers in the following ways. Number 1, improvement of breeds of the domesticated animals. Number 2, increasing the yield of the foodstuffs such as milk, eggs and meat. Number 3, proper management of the domestic animals in the terms of shelter, feeding care and protection against disease, which ultimately helps the farmers to improve their economic condition. Question number 6 was, for increasing the production, what is common in the poultry, fisheries and beekeeping? Answer: the common factors for increasing the production in poultry, fisheries and beekeeping is the proper management techniques that are to be followed. They are regular cleaning of the farms, that is of utmost importance. Second is maintenance of the temperature. Third is prevention and the cure of disease. It is also required to increase the number of animals. Question number 7 was, how do you differentiate between capture fishing, mariculture and aquaculture? Answer: capture fishing is a method of obtaining fishes from natural resources like pond, sea, lake, etc. Mariculture and aquaculture. Aquaculture is the farming of saltwater and freshwater organisms like finfish, crustaceans, mollusks and aquatic plants. And last is mariculture, that is a specialized branch of aquaculture that involves the cultivation of marine organisms for food and other products in the open ocean. So you will have to explain these 3. It's your wish. If you write in tabular form, that will be very good. So this ends for today's chapter. I hope you all are clear with your doubts now. So what is your homework, class? Assignment 1, it will be uploaded on 2nd July. Assignment 2 will be uploaded on 3rd July. And assignment 3 will be uploaded on 4th July. So you will have to check EdQuark on daily basis. And also, the test of this chapter will be there on 7th of July, that is Tuesday. So keep preparing side by side. So that's all. थैंक यू क्लास।